In the process of building my new net zero home, I've heard time and time again from many of you that my home's highly energy efficient features are considered standard in other areas of the world. From the type of window construction to the method of heating water, there's plenty of room for improvement. But when tech that goes beyond standard here in the US is par for the course elsewhere, this begs the question, why do American houses suck, especially compared to European ones? And what can we do to make them better? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. A portion of this video is brought to you by Surfshark, but more on that later. Where else but the States is it both legal and common to cover houses in sheathing that is literally paper thin, as in weak enough to be opened up with a knife, which might be equally as embarrassing as being blown down by a wolf? Now, this isn't a new trend either. It's been the norm for decades. Now, I've clearly tried my best to steer way clear of that. In my new home, I've gone with factory-built walls with densely packed cellulose insulation. The house is also outfitted with triple-paned tilt-turn windows, geothermal heating and cooling, and a heat pump for hot water, and my clothes dryer. I'm also running an energy recovery ventilator, or ERV, that allows for fresh air in a very airtight envelope. Now, this is all considered very common in other areas of the world. I'll get back to how some of this tech and those building techniques impact the bottom line in a bit, though. Broadly speaking, it's no secret that the US has been dragging its feet in the global energy transition. Just take it from the American Council for Energy Efficient Economy, or ACE, but I'm going to refer to it as ACE. That's one heck of an acronym. Now, according to their 2022 International Energy Efficiency Scorecard, the US ranks number 10 on a list of 25 countries representing the world's largest energy users. As the organization notes, the US is one of the very few large energy-consuming economies that lacks national energy reduction targets. However, what you might find surprising is how deeply these differences affect our construction of our homes right from the ground up. A good half of my viewership is located outside the United States. As I've talked about the energy-efficient tech that I'm implementing in my new home, I've gained insight into how it stacks up to other countries through your comments. Three concepts in particular have kept cropping up: the insulation or R values, the level of airtightness, and the triple glazed tilt-turn windows. Now, everybody loves to vent, so let's start with the windows. European windows are known for their high performance, particularly the triple glazed glass and tilt-and-turn frames that open inward and provide a very strong seal. Several European manufacturers meet the necessary standards set by the Passive House Institute in Germany. And this is no small feat, as Passive House's stringent requirements amount to both massive energy savings, sometimes up to 90%, and year-round comfort. I've explored how these impeccably designed structures work and the ways their principles can be applied in other types of buildings before, so if you're curious, be sure to check out some of those videos. I'll put links in the description. Triple glazed windows aren't unheard of here in the States. As a matter of fact, the windows in my new home were made here in the US, at least nominally close to the Passive House standards in terms of quality. It's difficult to make a clean comparison, though, because of the differences in how windows are tested, and of course, the United States' insistence on using imperial units. That's why I always talk about Fahrenheit and feet, and I always get ridiculed for it. In any case, while it's not impossible to get your hands on highly efficient windows here in the US, tilt and turn windows remain far less common. And it's definitely in part because European windows are typically more costly, often because of importing. It's also worth mentioning that back in 1991, researchers at the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory in California developed their own take on a thin triple-pane glass window that could reduce energy use and air conditioning costs. Their innovation never took off because American manufacturers found it too expensive. This attitude of prioritize lower costs in the present, ignore higher costs in the future, extends to pretty much everything in the US. I talk about how this relates to solar in my How Solar Got So Cheap So Fast video, so check that one out too. Now for a cushier topic and concept number two on my list, insulation. Before we get all warmed up on that topic, there's something else that can help insulate you from dangers online, and that's today's sponsor, Surfshark. I always recommend using a VPN when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be very useful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial tracking and machine learning to apply very targeted advertising. A VPN can protect you from some of that. Surfshark's clean web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet even at home. And you can make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. I used this exact feature on a trip I just took to Vancouver. And one of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all of your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. Links in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. So back to concept number 2, insulation. When it comes to determining how well a building can weather the elements, R values and U values measure thermal resistance and thermal transmittance, respectively. A higher R value means better resistance against heat flow, and therefore better insulation. U values are the opposite. It's more like how scores work in golf. You want a lower U value, which measures the time rate of heat flow. Of course, variations in geography mean that we can't make direct comparisons between, say, the entire US and the UK. As shown in this map within the Köppen-Geiger system, the most popular climate classification model, the majority of the UK lies in the Marine West subdivision. With that said, Washington State contains some of the few areas in the US categorized as Marine West climate zones. However, before we can examine how Washington's insulation requirements rank against other countries, we have to acknowledge another caveat complicating our bracket. Spend any amount of time paging through the state energy codes, and things quickly get messy, like really messy. That's because the United States doesn't have a national building code or a national energy code. They're instead handled on a state and even local basis. In fact, the US didn't have a comprehensive set of model construction standards until 1994. That year saw the establishment of the International Code Council, or ICC. The ICC went on to develop the International Building Code, or IBC, which has been adopted at the same level by all 50 states. The IBC updates every 3 years, and its current 2021 version instructs builders and designers to follow the International Energy Conservation Code, or IECC. And I promise that's the last I acronym I'll throw at you for now. But again, the IBC is a model. State and local governments can choose to amend the code or simply do their own thing. This map by the US Department of Energy Building Energy Codes Program shows how patchwork-like the efficiency of state energy codes is. Notice that some states are using standards as outdated as pre-2009 IECC, and some have no statewide code at all. Now, going back to Washington as an example, you can see that on this map it represents one of the handful of states with an up-to-date energy code. Its requirements for wall insulation still differ from those outlined by the IECC guidelines, though. So see those markings on the right-hand margin? Those are all amendments made by the state. When it comes to the insulation based on Washington's IECC-defined climate zones, the council's code mandates that residential walls have U values in no greater than 0.045 for wood frames or 0.082 for mass walls, which are made of materials like concrete or brick. But according to Washington's state code, as of July 2023, any wall above the ground needs to have a U value equal to or less than 0.056. Meanwhile, across the pond, English building regulations set maximum U values of walls at 0.046 in new buildings and 0.032 in existing ones. This means that even in the case of equivalent climate zone, Washington state codes aren't as strict as English code or the IECC. And for reference, where I live occupies the same climate slot according to the IECC. My walls have an R value of R35, which is equivalent to about a U value of 0.029. That's just slightly over the passive house standard for cool climates of about 0.026. I think that's enough decimals for one video, so we'll move on to airtightness, which thankfully can be expressed in whole numbers, and this is the third concept on my list. In this case, we'll discuss air changes per hour, or ACH, at a pressure of 50 pascals. It's also known as ACH50. Now, this is one way to quantify the rate of air leakage in the building, which is usually measured by conducting what's known as a blower door test. When designing the thermal envelope of a home, you want fewer air changes and therefore a lower ACH. And that's because the draftier a structure is, the less efficient it is. More air leakage means worse performance for ventilation systems and increasing the likelihood of accumulating moisture and increased energy costs. Plus, it's just plain uncomfortable. So what do building codes have to say about airtightness? Well, here's the maximum ACH 50 values as defined by the 2021 IECC, Washington State, and Canada. Then there's the US Department of Energy's Standards for a Zero Energy Ready Home, or ZERH, which is defined as a high-performance home that is so energy efficient that a renewable energy system could offset most or all of the home's annual energy use. It's what I'm trying to do at my new house. Now in version 2 of the ZERH requirements for detached single-family homes, ACH values are more stringent than the IECC. But for a building to meet the ultra-efficient criteria that defines a passive house, its air changes per hour must max out at about 0.6. Yep, less than 1. But of course there's more nuance to this, but I'll have to get into that in a separate video. But for right now, let's just stick to that 0.6 number. Now you might be thinking, sure, codes and enforcement of codes can reflect a country's dedication to energy efficiency on paper, but do they actually do anything? It sure seems so. For example, Canada's national model codes didn't include energy efficiency requirements until 2011. Before making that decision, the Canadian Commission on Building and Fire Codes commissioned an analysis of its potential efficacy. The report found that energy codes have the potential to affect up to 81% of energy use in houses and up to 68% of energy use in buildings, amounting not just to an increase in efficiency, but a reduction of greenhouse gas emissions and long-term operational costs. It's cheaper in the long run. Unfortunately, within the US, it's widely believed that energy efficiency is always a luxury, despite the cost savings of renewables and systems like passive house standards that have demonstrated otherwise. That's a whole topic unto itself, and I think Matt Ressinger of The Build Show said it best on a recent interview on my Still To Be Determined podcast when he referenced a quote from architect Steve Basic.
It's not that high-performance homes cost too much. It's that our idea of a fairly priced new home is based on a history of building houses to meet embarrassingly low performance benchmarks.
I can speak to why energy efficiency is so worth it myself. According to my home energy rating certificate, I'll be saving approximately $5,891 on energy costs relative to the average home in my area. And that's not including the impact of my solar panels on my energy bill, which are just getting installed and commissioned now as I pull this video together. There's also a correlation between the popularity of passive houses and well-developed comprehensively applied energy code. With this in mind, we can compare countries' interest in net zero construction easy peasy, because the Passive House Institute conveniently maintains an online database. Considering the locations of the self-registered buildings certified by the organization, the numbers line up nicely with ACE's scorecard. The countries that boast hundreds of passive houses on the website also happen to be the top three scorers, with 439 in France, 206 in the UK, and 532 in Germany, in that order. Again, that's only the ones that are both certified and registered on the database. According to Passive House Institute founder Wolfgang Feist, by 2006, between 6,000 and 7,000 passive houses had been constructed in Germany. Building codes clearly make a difference. So why are they so sparsely implemented here in the US? Well, the most significant obstacle to prioritizing energy efficiency anywhere is political will and money. We don't have to look much further than the energy crisis that pervaded the 1970s to understand why. The tactics governments used to mitigate the damage caused by the era's oil shocks signify a major turning point in both policy and public perception. Suddenly, the illusion of bountiful, endless supplies of cheap fuel was evaporating into exhaust. Here's what it was like from Matt's perspective.
And I think as Americans, we started really becoming interested in high-performance homes in the 70s because it seemed crazy for us to think about spending money on energy.
Decisions like the Nixon administration's focus on establishing diplomatic ties with oil-exporting Saudi Arabia and the Reagan administration's emphasis on defunding and even suppressing investment into renewables have made the U.S.'s priorities at the time very clear. These factors translated into cheaper energy for Americans relative to other places, which has remained stable in the present. You can see in this graph by the International Energy Agency how the percentage of household income spent on energy costs in the US is all the way on the lowest end relative to other major economies. The problem is that with cheap energy came a general disinterest in efficiency. Even now, the US uses significantly more energy at home or on the road than other countries, according to the IEA data. And I agree with Matt on this point.
I think this is something that's been kind of embedded in American culture for a long time. The problem happened though, I think, Matt, in the 80s when gas prices kind of rolled back quite a bit and we enjoyed a pretty long period of time without a massive increase in gas prices. Our general wages were going up and gas prices were staying kind of flat. That's not what happened in Europe. It was 20 years ago when I visited Europe for the first time as a 20-something. And I couldn't believe that converting the liters to gallons, they were paying like $8 a gallon or $9 a gallon for gas. So it really made sense for me that I saw these small Peugeots and these, you know, Mini Cooper-like cars, because if you're paying $9 for gas, you know, you're going to all of a sudden be a lot more interested in efficiency, whether it's mandated or not.
But as the United States scrambled to return to business as usual in the 1970s, France invested in generating its own nuclear power. It now operates one of the largest nuclear programs in the world, with nuclear power plants responsible for generating 68% of France's electricity in 2021. And already in the mid-1980s, the construction of new buildings meant compliance with low energy standards in Sweden and Denmark. Then the research that kicked off the passive house movement began in 1988. The initial prototype house in Germany that still stands and functions today was first occupied in 1991. In the end, there's no better microcosm of the United States' attitude about powering buildings with clean energy than the White House itself. The Carter administration installed solar panels on its roof in 1979. The Reagan administration removed them in 1986, the same year it terminated the solar tax credit. Photovoltaics remained off the House's grounds until the early 2000s. Around the same time in 2002, the Energy Division of the European Commission released the first Energy Performance of Buildings Directive, the EU's first whole building energy standard. Though the directive allows for the member states of the EU to make their own decisions about elements like U-values, it established guidelines and guidance for construction of low to zero energy buildings by 2021. Meanwhile, it's 2023 and the US doesn't have a centralized building code, much less a goal. So why do American houses suck? I'll let Ted Benson, founder of Benson Wood, clue you in.
We just don't take home building in particular as seriously as other countries do.
Okay.
And so, you know, the standards that we have in our building codes are just too low.
Do you think the US can do better? Are you interested in a more energy efficient home? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined. We'll be discussing some of your feedback. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every video. I'll see you in the next one.